Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Becoming by Jessica Meigs. Narrated by Shaina Summerville. Prologue. Atlanta, Georgia. Brandt Evans' scuffed black combat boots struck the pavement as he ran down the rain-dampened street, his heart hammering wildly against his ribs like it was trying to beat free from his chest. His breathing was loud and harsh. His hands sweated and shook uncontrollably. His whole body was on edge. He'd been running for over half an hour. Brandt ducked into an alley without slowing his pace and dropped down beside a smelly, overflowing green dumpster to hide. Leaning against the cool brick wall, he felt the solidness of it, the rough stone scraping against his back through his thin t-shirt. He closed his eyes and struggled to breathe. His lungs burned. His eyes hurt. He was a rabbit trying to outrun a fox. Hunted. Desperate. He just needed a moment to rest. Just one moment. He could spare a moment, couldn't he? Brandt leaned forward and peered at the alley's opening, taking in a deep breath of the sharp, cold January air and rubbing his hands over each of his arms in turn to ward off the chill. He desperately wished he had a jacket as he hunched over and shivered. He held his breath until his chest ached, and then he slowly released it. It clouded the air before his face. He thought he might have lost them, but he didn't want to take any chances. There was no way to know how many had followed him, how many had caught his scent. He had to assume it wasn't just one or two. He had to assume he was being pursued, always pursued. If he let his guard down. Brandt wiped his sweating palms down the thighs of his camouflage pants and leaned back against the wall again. He knew what would happen if he were caught. He'd seen too many people, his sister included, succumb to the plague. He knew if he were caught, it would all end in blood and pain and death. It wasn't the end he'd envisioned for himself, and he refused to let it turn out that way. He had to get out of the city as soon as he could, if he expected to survive. He had to run. He had to get ahead of the infection, flee, and find a safe place to hide. A faint noise echoed from the alleyway's entrance. Brandt's heart jumped into his throat and choked him. He peered around the edge of the dumpster again, and his hand wandered to the Beretta M9 pistol at his hip. He drew it and ejected the magazine to look inside. It was empty, as expected. He pulled back the slide. He already knew what he'd find. A single bullet. The one he'd carefully counted ammunition to save, just in case. But he was nothing if not a survivor, even if his survival had been forced out of him on a promise he hadn't wanted to make. He snapped the magazine back into the pistol as quietly as he could. The sound was too loud to his ears, and he worried that the simple action would draw unwanted attention to him. As if on cue, a shuffling noise came from the other side of the dumpster. A quiet snarl and an odd snuffling sound followed it. Brandt closed his eyes and instinctively pressed back more firmly against the brick. He became the rabbit again, shrinking back among the loose trash that skittered about in the stiff, cold wind. He hoped against hope he wouldn't be sniffed out. Another jolt of adrenaline pumped into Brandt's veins as an ominous chill ran down his spine and raised the hair on the back of his neck. His instincts whispered that there wasn't going to be an escape from this one. He wasn't sure how much more of this he could take. The idea of being chased, of being caught, was slowly driving him insane. He had to do something, anything, to alleviate the awful sensation. Brandt took a deep, steadying breath and stood abruptly. His head swam at the sudden movement. His vision dimmed and the alleyway spun around him. His heart lurched in his chest. Shaking his head, he caught his hand against the dumpster to steady himself and lifted the pistol. The weapon felt incredibly heavy and the barrel trembled. He swallowed and curled his finger to depress the trigger. Time slowed to a crawl. The last bullet left the pistol with a bang. The projectile whipped past the blood-covered man who ran down the alleyway toward him. It embedded into the wall with a splatter of brick. Shards of red stone sprayed the man and cut into his cheek. He was unaffected as he continued his mindless pursuit. Brandt stumbled back, and the emptied Beretta fell from his limp hand to the pavement. He looked left and right frantically, thoughts blazing through his mind in a flurry, faster than he could catch them. His shot had missed? How had it missed when the target was so close? He was an expert marksman, for Christ's sake. He wasn't supposed to miss. Brandt swore under his breath and mentally inventoried the weapons left on his person. There hadn't been much to begin with. Just the sidearm that now lay expended on the pavement and a rifle he'd abandoned once he had run out of ammunition for it, the extra weight of the spent weapon having been a hindrance. He took a couple of steps back and remembered the one weapon he had left. Brandt knelt and pulled his K-bar knife free from the sheath strapped to the outside of his right boot. It wasn't much, and he wasn't sure how much damage the 7-inch blade could actually cause to one of these attackers, but it was all he had left. He stood just in time. The man launched himself at Brandt, hands extended, animalistic hatred in his red-rimmed, bloodshot eyes. Instinct guided him as he lifted the knife sharply upward and stood from his kneeling position. In one smooth move, Brandt slammed the knife's blade into the fleshy underside of the man's lower jaw. To Brandt's dismay, the man's gnarled hands closed in tight fists in his shirt, and he shook his head violently to free the knife from his jaw. Trapped, Brandt struggled to pull himself from the man's grip, but the man was stronger than he looked. So he did the only thing he could. He wrenched the knife from the man's jaw and slammed it into his left temple. As the blade struck home, the man's forward momentum carried him a few more steps. He leaned heavily against Brandt, then fell to the pavement in a heap. Brandt backed away from the body, shuddering as nausea welled up in his throat. He shook it off and took his first real look at the man who'd attacked him. He wasn't anyone Brandt recognized, which was the best news he'd get all day. This man was too old to have been a current member of the military. He was around 70, thin and bony and wrinkled with age, hair white and sparse on his head. He was clad in dirtied sweatpants and a blood-stained white bathrobe, his feet bare and torn from running without shoes on the cold, unforgiving streets and sidewalks of Atlanta. The elderly man was definitely a civilian, possibly from one of the local nursing homes. Judging by the crusted blood under his lengthening, yellowed fingernails, the man had been ill for at least 4 days. Brandt grasped the hilt of his knife and pulled it free from the man's temple. It slid away from the bone and flesh with an indescribable sound that made him shudder in disgust. He took a moment to wipe the blood from the blade onto the edge of the dead man's bathrobe. He had no desire to continue his exam of the body. He looked instead to the Beretta lying on the wet pavement. The weapon was empty and wouldn't do him any further good. The chances he'd find much suitable ammunition for it in a city under siege were slim, and searching for it wasn't worth his time. The general populace had days before raided the gun shops and sports stores in the city for anything usable that had been left behind by the military, and all of the ammunition shelves were likely bare. Nevertheless, he scooped the gun up and jammed it into the holster on his belt. Brandt looked around the darkening alley. Night had begun to fall, the dusk settling over the alley and making it difficult to see. He tried to center his mind and figure out where to go, what to do. He couldn't stay on the streets in the dark. It increased his chances of being killed tenfold. The city still crumbled around him, so he needed to move fast. His options were severely limited. He turned in a slow circle and spotted a red ladder hanging at the end of the alley, almost invisible in the dark. A fire escape, he realized. It at least offered an alternative to returning to the street. He glanced over his shoulder to make sure nothing else was coming in his direction, then returned the knife to its sheath and jumped up. He caught the bottom rung of the ladder and hauled himself onto it, his biceps bulging as he dragged himself up. He began climbing as quickly as he dared. The metal rungs were slick with rain and ice, and they bit into Brandt's palms and fingers as he trekked up the ladder. His boots slipped on the icy rungs more than once and sent his heart faltering in his chest. It was only through his own reflexes that he didn't fall from the ladder into the pavement below. The thought of breaking bones and leaving himself helpless was enough to keep him on his guard. There'd be no survival for him if he ended up with a broken leg in a dirty alley in downtown Atlanta. In that situation, he could just slap a sign on himself that said dinner and lie back to wait for the end. Brandt reached the roof easily enough and gained his footing on the flat, graveled surface. From there, he took a few moments to look out across the city and plan his next step. Smoke billowed on the horizon, close to the edge of the downtown metro area. A tornado siren blasted its monotonous refrain from somewhere in the city, warning Atlanta residents to get to a safe place. Gunfire rang out too close to his position for comfort. Screams echoed faintly through the streets nearby, but he didn't dare check out the source. An ambulance siren played its part in the symphony of a city falling in on itself. Brandt dropped to his knees, suddenly overwhelmed by all the trauma he'd experienced that day. He ignored the gravel digging into his skin through his pants and covered his mouth as he fought off the bile that rose in his throat. The horror he'd faced throbbed in his brain even as he closed his eyes. The things he'd seen and experienced that day were worse than anything he'd ever dreamed of. It was all he could do to remain upright as he fought to choke back the sickness in his mouth and soul. He couldn't hold it back, though, and he hunched over the gravel and vomited. His throat burned and his eyes watered as he gripped the edge of the building and dug his fingers into the stone. His chest heaved as he coughed up the remains of his last sparse meal. He rocked back on his heels, wiping at his mouth with the back of his hand, and cleared his throat. The taste in his mouth was awful, but it was the last thing on his mind. He felt at his face, testing his own temperature as best he could. He couldn't tell if he was running a fever, or if it was just heat generated by his climb up the fire escape ladder. He was sure he'd be feeling the symptoms by now if... Brandt shook his head, clearing his throat once more as he took in the view. "A virus did all this," he whispered hoarsely. He looked upon the city once more. The city in which he'd grown up. The city he'd loved more than any other city he'd seen in his time in the military. It was like nothing Brandt had ever witnessed before. It was the beginning of the end of civilization, and the thought terrified him. How can this even be possible? Dr. Derek Rivers was wrong. He had to be wrong. The man who'd freed him and given him the chance to get this far was long dead, one of the early victims of the viral outbreak that, even now, swept over Atlanta and beyond with a speed to rival the Black Death itself. Brandt had thought that Derek had exaggerated when he'd told him what was going on in the outside world. But he hadn't exaggerated. Indeed, he hadn't gone far enough in his description of the total devastation that the virus had visited upon the city. "Which way? Which way?" he whispered. He forced himself to his feet once more. It wasn't time to be puking on a roof and reminiscing about men who were likely dead. He slowly surveyed the rooftop, searching for an escape route and a plan. He looked in every direction, uncertain which way would be safest. None of them, really. Safety was a foreign concept to Atlanta now. Before Brandt went anywhere, though, he needed weapons. He needed food. He needed water. And he needed a safe place to hide for the night. Chapter 1. Plantersville, Mississippi. 3 days later. Gray Carter leaned halfway under the hood of an older model Honda Civic, up to his elbows in grease and a grimace of concentration on his face, when a hand clapped against his back. Startled, he narrowly avoided striking his head on the underside of the hood before straightening and turning his grimace onto whoever had snuck up on him. His 25-year-old brother Theo stood beside him, attired in his immaculate paramedic uniform, his blonde hair neatly combed and his blue eyes dancing with merriment. He held a takeout drink tray and a bag of what smelled like something fatty and greasy in one hand, and a wicked grin crossed his face. I didn't scare you, did I? Oh, shut up, asshole, Gray replied, though he couldn't stop a grin from spreading across his own face. He tugged the well-used rag from the back pocket of his coveralls and scrubbed at the filth that had accumulated on his hands. Engine grease had worked its way under his nails and into the creases of his skin, and he had no hope of getting it all out without liberal amounts of dish soap. What are you doing here? He asked, stuffing the rag back in his pocket. I thought you had to work today. I'll go in later this evening, Theo replied. I'm just covering for Justin while he's in class. I figured I'd grab us some lunch and drop in to see how you're doing. He looked past Gray at the vehicle and asked, What's wrong with this one? Foobard alternator, he said. He nodded towards the white door that led from the service bays to the garage's administrative offices. There's a sink in the break room. I can wash up in there. Gray led the way through the noisy garage, trying to tune out the sounds of the other mechanics banging around under the hoods of cars and calling out to each other. Somewhere, music blasted on the radio. R&B that drove Gray crazy day in and day out. But he wasn't allowed to listen to music on headphones while servicing a customer's car. So he had to endure the torture. As he pushed the doors open to enter the building, the music cut out and an announcer broke in. We interrupt your regular programming to bring you a breaking news announcement. The door swung shut behind him and Theo, and Gray didn't hear what was said. It was probably nothing important anyway. Half of the news cycles were full of breaking news lately, and the vast majority of notices were inconsequential. After an intense scrubbing session with dish detergent and a rag, Gray sat down in the folding metal chair across from his brother to the feast of cheap cheeseburgers and greasy fries that Theo had unpacked from the sack. You did get mine with no pickles, right? Gray asked. Theo blew the paper wrapper off his straw, shooting it across the table at him, and Gray swatted it out of the air. What do you think I am? Theo asked. Some kind of an idiot? Well, Gray drew out the word and laughed when Theo gave him a mock offended look. I'm kidding, okay? I know you got it without pickles. You never don't get it without pickles. I don't understand your aversion to pickles, Theo said. He unwrapped his burger and took a messy bite, adding with his mouth full of meat and bread, They're awesome. Gray wrinkled his nose but didn't reply. He bowed his head and recited the brief prayer of thanks he always made before eating. When he finished, he lifted his head to see Theo nibbling at a fry, smiling patiently. He returned the smile and dug into his cheeseburger. You still do that prayer thing before you eat? Theo asked once they'd both settled into the groove of their meals. Gray shrugged and finished his mouthful of burger before responding. Yeah, of course, he said. Why? Don't you? Theo dabbed a fry in some ketchup. Occasionally, whenever I think about it, which isn't often. He took a bite of burger and reclined in his chair. Hey, I have tomorrow off. After I get some sleep, do you want to go out in the town, do whatever? Yeah, sure. Sounds like fun. Gray agreed. We can go bar hopping or something. Maybe pick up a couple of chicks, huh? Theo snorted. You're the most unconvincing womanizer ever, he joked. You're too baby-faced for one-night stands. Gray threw a fry at him. Oh, come on. I'm not any more baby-faced than you are. He bit his tongue to keep from bringing up suspicions he'd been harboring about his brother's sexuality. Suspicions that Theo always seemed to go out of his way to deflect. Yeah, you keep telling yourself that. The twinkle of mischievousness in Theo's eyes showed that he was joking, but it still rankled Gray's nerves nonetheless. Before he could come up with a good retort, though, Theo said, Oh, I almost forgot. He leaned back in his chair, dug into the pocket by his right knee, and tossed a box at him. I got your prescription refilled for you earlier. Gray caught the box and glanced at the label, then stuffed it into his pocket. Thanks. I hadn't even thought about it. See? This is why I still hang around you, Theo said, waving a fry in his direction. If I decide to, I don't know, stop coming by to see you, you'd forget to get your meds refilled and would end up suffocating to death. Gray made a face at him and stuffed the last of his cheeseburger into his mouth. You've got to give me a little credit. Why would I want to do that? Theo laughed. It takes all the fun out of screwing with you. Gray sighed. Don't you have somewhere to be? Like maybe work, saving people's lives instead of sitting here making mine miserable? I should be offended, but I don't think it's worth the energy. Not after last night, Theo said with a chuckle, grimacing. The disparity between the expression on his face and the sound he made was disconcerting. At his questioning look, Theo explained, "Had to work a car accident. There was a kid involved. Those are always hard." Gray frowned and leaned over the table, resting his elbows on the edge and studying Theo. "You okay?" "Hey, it's what I signed up for, isn't it? I wouldn't have made it through paramedic training if I couldn't handle it." He took a sip of soda. "It just gets rough when kids are hurt. Emotions and all that shit try to get in the way." "I could never do what you do," Gray said. He started cleaning up their trash, shoving the empty wrappers back in the bag. "I'd be entirely too nervous with other people's lives in my hands." Theo stood to help him wipe down the table. "It keeps roofs over our heads, so I do what I have to do." "Yeah, I know, and I thank you for that," Gray said. "God knows I don't pull in enough here to do much other than keep me in groceries and maybe pay my cell phone bill." "How's the apartment working out for you?" Theo asked. "Is everything still okay there?" "Yeah, it's fine," Gray assured him with a sheepish smile. "I don't know. It's okay, it's just not home, you know?" "I know," Theo sighed. "I'm sorry about all this. I've been arguing the case with Dr. Taylor every time I see him, but he's not budging. I don't know what to do next." Gray glanced at the clock above the door. The second hand ticked inexorably toward the 12. He sighed and headed for the trash can, jamming the bag into it. "As stimulating as this depressing conversation is, I have to get back to work. I've still got 3 hours to finish this car and get chewed out by the boss for only getting 2 cars done today." "Yeah, I've got to get to work myself soon," Theo said. Gray headed out the door and back into the service bays, his brother right behind him. Before he went to his car, Theo stopped him. "Hey, be careful going home this evening, okay? Seems like we've been working a lot of wrecks over the past couple of days, and there are rumors of some scary shit going on over in Georgia and Alabama. I don't want to have to come scrape you off the highway." Gray smiled tightly. While he was touched that Theo was concerned enough to say something, his brother's overprotectiveness had become almost stifling over the past few months. "Maybe I'm just getting used to staying by myself," he thought. He wasn't sure if that was a good thing or not. "I'll be fine, Theo," he promised. "It's not like I drive like a bat out of hell. Besides, I take that route home 5 days a week. It's nothing new." I know," Theo said. "Can't blame you for tossing that out there anyway, right?" He patted Gray on the back. "See you later, man." He started to walk toward his car, but didn't make it more than a few steps before turning and adding, "Oh, boss man at the base said he'd really appreciate it if you could come by when you had time to take a look at one of the ambulances. He thinks it's a fuel injector issue again." Gray waved a hand at him dismissively. "Tell Doug I'll see what I can do. I'll give him a call in the morning to make arrangements." He shook his head. "I don't know why I let myself get roped into constantly fixing those junkers for you guys." "Because you're just that damn good, Gray," Theo said. "And admit it. You're a total sucker for a big engine." He retreated to his car, slid in, and shut the door. Gray was still laughing when his brother pulled out of the lot. New Orleans, Louisiana. Your parents are so going to kill you. Remy Angelette wrinkled her nose and scoffed at the girl in the driver's seat, turning her arm around to study the design that had been newly inked onto her left bicep. The skin was still tender and sore from the experience of having dozens of needles rapidly jabbed into it. But in her opinion, the pain had been well worth it. It wasn't her first tattoo. Not by far. And by now, her mother should have expected this sort of thing from her. She wasn't particularly worried about either her mother's or her stepfather's reactions to the newest edition of art on her body. Mom will be fine with it, she assured Casey. She's pretty open-minded about stuff like this. And Jason isn't my father, so I don't really care what he thinks. Yeah, but what would your real dad think? Remy glanced at the new tattooed dragon on her arm again and looked at Casey with a smile. I can imagine he'd definitely approve. Did you forget he had, like, 18 tattoos himself? No, I hadn't forgotten, Casey said. Your dad was only the coolest person in existence. She reached to turn the radio's volume up a notch when a rock song came on, piped in via Bluetooth from the iPhone in the console between the two black leather seats. Remy scooped up the phone to see who the song was by and found it wasn't anyone she'd ever heard of. It was rather catchy, though, and she bobbed her head with the music, subconsciously tapping her foot on the floorboard. So, what are your plans for today? She asked, raising her voice to be heard over the thumping beat from the stereo. I have a paper to write, Casey said with a motion of her hand to the messenger bag by Remy's feet. Elizabeth Browning! Could be worse, Remy said thoughtfully. Her love poems were pretty awesome. Yeah, definitely could be worse. Remy shifted against the leather seat again, trying to make herself comfortable, and realized her bare shoulder had stuck to the leather in the warmth of the car. She didn't want to imagine what the seat was doing to her bare thighs. She leaned forward slightly to unstick her shoulder from the seat and pulled her dark hair back with one hand, holding it off her neck in a makeshift ponytail. I've been thinking of maybe going to college, Remy piped up. Maybe majoring in something to do with music? Remy, with the way you get tattoos and buy guitars and stuff, you'd never be able to afford it, Casey pointed out matter-of-factly. I know. It'd be nice, though. Remy let go of her hair and tucked the locks behind her ears, careful to avoid the still-healing ring that pierced the cartilage of her left ear. It'd give me something to do besides stare at a computer screen and surf the internet all day. I thought you liked surfing the internet all day, Casey teased. I do. But Facebook only stays entertaining for so long. And Twitter is just starting to get old, Remy complained. I need something new to happen in my life. I need all this monotony broken, you know? We should go out and do something spontaneous, Casey suggested. Maybe take a road trip or something. What do you think? Remy shrugged half-heartedly and grabbed her water bottle from the pocket in the door. She took a sip and thought it over. I don't know. Maybe, she said. I don't know if I'd have the money for something like that. Maybe you could get a new job, Casey said. She steered the Mustang off the paved highway and onto a dirt road winding back into the trees. Yeah, and maybe I could get a lobotomy too, she said, taking another sip from her bottle. I heard Mr. Carter, you know, the swim coach from the high school. I heard he's looking for someone to help lifeguard at the pool this spring. Remy pushed her hair back from her face again. I don't know. I'll think about it, okay? She conceded. Mr. Carter is a douche, though, so I doubt I'll even consider working for him. Well, just work for somebody, Casey pressed. Then you can buy your own car and quit bumming rides off of me all the time. But Casey, your Mustang is just so nice, Remy said as the car bumped to a stop outside her house. Dodson, the mailbox read. She glanced at it and rolled her eyes before unlocking the passenger door and sliding to the edge of the seat. I'll see you later, chick. FaceTime me after dinner when you get the chance. Will do, Casey said cheerfully. She waved her fingers at Remy, and Remy returned the gesture and walked toward the house. Casey pulled away as Remy reached the bottom of the porch steps, which she was silently thankful for. It didn't matter how many times Casey had been there. Remy was still embarrassed to have her friends see her house. When she climbed the wooden steps leading to the porch, the planks wobbled under her chucks, but she was used to it. Despite her attempts to repair the broken steps, they'd stayed irreparably shaky for as long as she could remember. The porch wasn't much better. She stepped nimbly around the soft, rotten spots in the wood and took out her keys, unlocking the front door and stepping into the stuffy house. A soft, repetitive clicking sound was coming from the kitchen, so Remy started in that direction, scooping a stray hair clip off the table by the door and twisting her long hair into a bun, fastening it on top of her head. She found her mother standing at the kitchen counter, knife in hand, chopping a butternut squash into cubes. "Hi, Mom," she greeted. She dropped a kiss on her cheek, then went to the fridge to get a bottle of tea. "Any mail for me today?"
"Wah, were you expecting some?"
her mother asked.
"Nothing in particular,"
she replied. It was a lie, but she hoped not an obvious one. She'd been hoping for a package she'd ordered the week before from an online adult novelty store. She hopped up onto a stool by the counter and cracked her tea bottle open, taking a swig.
"What's for dinner?"
Her mother scooped up a handful of squash cubes with the blade of her knife and dumped it into a bowl.
"I thought I asked you not to get any more of those," she said,
her voice tinged with disappointment and disapproval.
"Get any more of what?" she asked, playing dumb.
"Tattoos," her mother said. "It's not ladylike."
"Mama, I'm not ladylike,"
Remy argued. There were chopped carrots in a bowl, and she stole one and popped it into her mouth, crunching it between her teeth.
"And I'm over 18. I don't see what the big deal is. It's just a tattoo. It's not like I'm doing drugs or anything."
Remy's mother seemed willing to drop the subject at her declaration. Remy smirked triumphantly and reached for another bite of carrot, only to receive a smack on the back of her hand with the flat of her mother's knife.
"Dinner will be ready in an hour," her mother said. "Go do something useful. Clean your room."
She looked Remy over and added,
"And put on something other than that skirt. It's too short, and you know how your stepfather feels about that."
"Yeah, well, I don't really care what he thinks," Remy mumbled.
She retreated before her mother could interject, heading straight to her bedroom upstairs. Once inside, she shut and locked the door, grinning in satisfaction. She headed for her closet, unfastening her skirt in mid-walk to find something a little less revealing to change into. After donning her favorite lounge pants and a t-shirt with an image of an old computer on it that said, "I have a terrible memory," she buzzed over to her computer, jiggled the mouse to wake the screen up, and with a few keystrokes, she was online and checking her email. She had an hour before dinner was ready, and she had every intention of spending it online with her digital friends. Remy had a routine for her online activities. She always did everything in a certain order, as if she were afraid she'd miss some snippet of news or gossip that would drastically alter her life. Email, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and several forums she found interesting. It was always the same. From there, she went wherever the internet took her. As such, that was how it took Remy until well after she'd waded through a flood of emails that had hit her inbox to find out something was going on. The first indication that all wasn't right was a single tweet she spotted on Twitter. Kelly Rogers at Hot in Atlanta. 1 hour. Something going on here in hashtag Atlanta. Cell signal spotty. Phones don't work. Military all over the street outside. Remy frowned and leaned closer to the screen, scrolling down the timeline, searching for another reference to Atlanta, her brain shuffling through the myriad reasons why the military would be on the streets of Atlanta. She spotted another tweet halfway down the page. This one from an indie band based in Atlanta that she'd met once when they opened for one of her favorite bands at a smaller venue. Shred the strings at Shred the Strings ATL. 56 minutes. Entire town shut down. Hashtag ATL toast. Rumor is riots. Virus. No idea what's going on. No in or out. and then a third. Jordan K. Miller at Emery Baby. 48 minutes. I heard hashtag EmeryU was on lockdown. My sister heard gunshots outside. I don't think this is good.
Remy snorted softly. You're telling me?
She refreshed the page, and her frown deepened as the tweets vanished like they'd never existed. She jabbed refresh on her computer a few more times, then spun her chair toward her TV. Maybe she'd find some useful news about Atlanta on there. Plannersville, Mississippi. Whenever Theo had to work pickup shifts like the one he'd agreed to fill in for that evening, he always found himself praying for a quiet time of it. But it was the weekend, and teenagers in Plannersville had little to do besides throw drunken parties and cause problems for the police and EMS crews in the area. Considering the rumors already circulating about a party to be held at one of the houses on the outskirts of town, he had no doubt it had proved to be a very busy shift. Theo found his driver, Jonathan Kramer, already sitting sideways on the passenger seat of their truck when he arrived at the base a few minutes before the start of his shift. He dropped his bag off in the room in which he'd spend his downtime, punched in, and joined Jonathan outside.
Hey, Carter, how's it going?
Jonathan greeted. Theo shrugged and ran a hand through his dark blonde hair.
It's going. How was drill last weekend? It was okay, Jonathan replied. The usual. Sarge was a dick. Nothing new about that, though.
He thrust a sheet of paper toward Theo.
New marching orders from Doug. Some supplies have been disappearing from a few trucks, and he can't figure out if it's because they're not being logged into the computer properly. He wants us to inventory the trucks on paper at the beginning and end of every shift, in addition to accounting for supplies on each of the run reports.
Theo took the paper and skimmed it.
Well, that's all fine and dandy, but this all looks like extra work for just me. Oh, I've got my own.
Jonathan held up a sheet with a shorter list.
Crawling in the fucking dirt, checking the PSI and tires. That's maintenance's job. Fucking ridiculous. Watch your language, Theo said absently, though he felt silly saying that to a man 10 years his senior.
He looked over the list one more time, then pulled the ambulance's side door open and hauled himself inside. He was greeted by the sight of dirty gloves, used nasal cannulas and non-rebreather masks, and plastic packaging littering the floor. Soiled linens were piled high on the bench by the back doors, and the garbage can attached to the side of the bench was overflowing with everything from used supplies to takeout bags.
Fucking hell! Theo exploded. What the fucking fuck is this? And you told me to watch my language? Jonathan joked. Needless to say, I wasn't pleased when I walked into this a few minutes ago. I figured you were going to hit the ceiling. Who the hell left it like this?
Theo asked, already freeing his cell phone from his pants pockets to take pictures of the mess for his supervisor's perusal later.
Probably the same douchebags who ran out of here the minute I showed up so they'd be gone by the time I found it like this.
Jonathan dropped out of the passenger seat and stretched, stepping into view of the side door.
Need a hand? I'm not averse to actually helping around here. Unlike some people.
He cast a glance toward a four-door coupe that flew out of the base's short driveway. Theo recognized one of the aforementioned douchebag co-workers behind the wheel. He snorted and turned his gaze back to the mess before them.
Get the stretcher out of the way and grab the broom from the backboard cabinet. I'm going to attempt to inventory while I clean.
He sniffed the air, his head tilted back like a hunting dog scenting for prey. He wrinkled his nose.
It smells like stale fries and piss in here. You smell that, or is it just me?
Jonathan snapped on a blue glove and circled to the ambulance's back doors, flipping them open. He picked something up from the floor of the ambulance and held it up with one finger for Theo to see. A male urinal.
Found your culprit.
He frowned at the floor.
Looks like it's leaked, too. So not only did they leave us with garbage everywhere, but they left us with a biohazard to deal with, too?
To say Theo was thoroughly disgusted was an understatement. He forced himself to stop grinding his teeth and slid open a cabinet, pulling out a red plastic bag.
Drop it in here and tie it off. I'll chuck it later.
It took Theo and Jonathan over an hour to scrub and sanitize the interior of the ambulance, replace the supplies that had been used, and inventory everything. By the time they'd finished, Theo felt a headache niggling at the base of his skull. He massaged his temples and heaved a weary sigh, before dropping into the airway seat with all the grace of a hippopotamus.
Aw, hell. We've still gotta wash the outside, don't we?
He grumbled.
Please tell me it looks like rain so he can put it off a little longer.
Jonathan cast his eyes skyward and shook his head.
Nope. Sorry. Crystal clear evening sky.
He smiled.
You know, if you don't want to wash it, I'm certainly not going to bitch. We could probably hold off until closer to the end of your shift. Hey, Jonathan!
A voice called from beyond the truck. It was a familiar one, and Theo sat up straighter in anticipation, his heart fluttering as the voice grew louder on the owner's approach. Jonathan leaned around the corner of the truck to get a look at the newcomer.
I hear Theo's supposed to be on shift tonight. Is he here yet?
Theo shoved himself out of the airway seat, nearly tripping over the trauma bag by the side door in his haste to get out of the truck. He stuck his head out the door, spotting Dylan Roberts standing outside, his brown hair glossy in the light from the setting sun and a cigarette dangling from the corner of his mouth.
He's right here,
Theo said, clambering down from his perch inside the ambulance. Dylan grinned and stepped forward, giving Theo a one-armed hug, holding his cigarette out with the other so he wouldn't accidentally burn him. Theo returned the embrace with the same enthusiasm.
Theo, it feels like it's been ages since I've seen you,
Dylan said once he'd stepped back.
It's been less than a week, Dill,
Theo replied, grinning.
How was your trip?
Theo had met Dylan a mere 6 months prior when, newly arrived from Florida, he'd crossed the street from his house to the ambulance base and introduced himself to Theo while Theo was washing the truck. Since then, they'd become close. Too close, some might have said, for it to be considered a simple friendship. Theo didn't care what other people thought. Dylan had been there for him through the rough patches of the last several months, including the personal upheaval that had ensued when his and Gray's therapist had diagnosed them with codependency and strongly recommended they get separate living spaces to help quell that problem. Dylan took a drag of his cigarette and turned his head to blow the smoke away from Theo.
Trip would have been a hell of a lot more fun if you'd taken the week off and come along like I asked you to.
I couldn't leave, he said. You know I had to stay here in case Gray needed me.
Gray's 21,
Dylan pointed out, not unkindly.
I think he'd have been fine on his own. He's living by himself now, right? Not totally, Theo admitted. I'm still paying his rent and everything. It's stretching me fucking thin. Why don't you talk to him about it? See if he'll get a second job to help out with that, Dylan asked.
He leaned against the side of the ambulance and Theo joined him, folding his arms.
You can only do so much, Theo, and you're already stressed out. You need a break.
He offered his cigarette to Theo, who accepted and took a deep drag.
That's why I wanted you to go to Biloxi with me. We both needed to get away for a while.
He cut his eyes toward the house across the street, and Theo followed his gaze.
Are you still having problems with...
He trailed off and looked at Dylan.
You have no idea, Dylan said. I'm so tired of everything lately.
He sighed.
Let's talk about better things. You busy tomorrow night? I was thinking maybe we could go get some drinks and hang out.
Theo hesitated, glancing toward the ambulance base, trying to think of a gentle way to phrase it.
I can't, he said. I've already got plans with Gray. We're supposed to go bar hopping tomorrow night.
The look of disappointment on Dylan's face was obvious.
Oh, come on, Theo. He's got his own friends he can go out with. You see him all the time.
Theo sighed. I know, but...
Don't you want to prove Dr. Taylor wrong?
Dylan asked, his voice gentle. He pressed his hand lightly against Theo's bare forearm.
Come on. Go out with me. What'll it hurt? You and Gray can make plans for some other time.
Theo sighed and shoved his hands into his pockets. Yeah, okay, fine. I'll reschedule with Gray. He won't be happy about it, though. You know how he feels about you.
Yep, he can't stand me, Dylan said almost cheerfully. Not that I care. He can think whatever he wants to think about me. No skin off my teeth.
He took one last drag from his cigarette before dropping it on the pavement and grinding it out with his tennis shoe.
Want breakfast in the morning after work? He offered. I'll cook. I always make too much anyway.
Sounds like a plan, he agreed. I'll even help. A burst of static came from the radio in the cab, followed by a loud tone that set Theo's teeth on edge.
Sounds like you're about to get a call, so I'll get on out of here, Dylan said,
patting Theo on the shoulder as the dispatcher started rattling off the address.
Give me a shout when you're freed up in the morning so I know when you're coming over.
Will do, Theo agreed. Dylan hugged him briefly, then retreated to the house across the street. Jonathan exited the base then, waving a notepad in Theo's direction.
We've got a call,
he shouted, making a beeline for the driver's door.
Chest pain.
Theo glanced at Dylan's retreating form and nodded, hauling himself into the truck.
Well then, let's get this show on the road.
Chapter 2. Memphis, Tennessee. Ethan Bennett's green eyes fluttered open slowly and reluctantly as he surfaced to consciousness. A beam of sunlight filtered through the blinds hanging over the window by the bed and insisted on shining directly onto his face. He groaned and rolled onto his side, squeezing his eyes closed again and trying to avoid the painfully bright light. His head hurt, and when he tried to swallow, his throat was rough, like it had been sandpapered. He had the distinct sensation of having been run over by a truck. Yes, he'd definitely drunk too much the night before. Ethan hadn't really meant to. It wasn't his normal MO to get so smashingly drunk. But when the police officers from his precinct in Memphis held off-duty get-togethers, things tended to get pretty wild. And it had been a celebration. He'd just been promoted, and his coworkers had felt that there was no better way to rejoice over such an event than to virtually kidnap him and drag him to the nearest bar for a few drinks. A few drinks had culminated in Ethan puking in some poor bastard's bushes and his co-workers laughing and taking pictures to mark the occasion. He hadn't lost his stomach like that since his days of illicit underage drinking in high school. It was more than a little embarrassing. Ethan rolled over and looked at Anna's side of the bed. It was empty, the pillow gone cold. He squinted at the alarm clock. Its red numbers seared a hole in his brain. It was almost noon. His wife had likely been awake and up for hours already. Ethan was usually up with her. The only time he ever slept in was when he'd had to work the graveyard shift at the station. Or when he was drunk. That wouldn't be happening very often anymore, though. He was a major now, the youngest by almost 8 years in all the precincts that made up the Memphis Police Department. He was barely 39, and he'd already risen to one of the highest ranks in the entire precinct. It was a serious accomplishment, but one that was hardly unexpected. Ethan had always taken his job seriously, and the rewards had always been plentiful. When the rumors of the position opening up had been circulating among the officers, it had been a given among the gossipers that Ethan Bennett would be offered the job. And now that he had been, he didn't know how his life could possibly get any better. He flopped onto his back and grunted, rubbing at his face with both hands. His palms met stubble and he grimaced. He needed to shave. He'd have to get out of bed to do it. The very idea was incompatible with the temptation to stay firmly ensconced in his blankets all day. He wondered where exactly Anna was. Neither of them had to work that day. Maybe he would take her out to dinner after his headache had subsided to tolerable levels. As the thought wandered through his brain, Ethan sat up in bed and looked around blearily. His eyes didn't want to focus. He spotted a note by the alarm clock and grabbed it. His wife's loopy handwriting greeted him.
Eth, I went next door to Cade's.
She's doing barbecue at her place this evening since it's such a nice day, and she invited us over. She says for you to bring the beer unless you used it all marinade in your liver last night. Come over when you're feeling up to getting out of bed. There are 2 aspirin on the sink in the bathroom and a little breakfast in the fridge if your stomach can handle it. Congrats on your promotion. Anna. P.S. I love you. Ethan grinned and slipped the note into his bedside table's drawer. A stack of similar notes was already inside. He didn't think he'd ever thrown a single one away. He climbed out of bed and stood awkwardly as the room swam, grabbing the bedpost to steady himself before making his way to the bathroom. The aspirin were right where the note had said they'd be. He swallowed both pills dry and steadied himself in the mirror above the sink. His eyes were bloodshot and red-rimmed, and his blonde hair, normally combed to look neat and professional, looked like a rat had slept in it. He shoved at it ineffectually and then lifted his arm for a sniff. That had been a mistake. He smelled like sweat, grime, booze, and cigarette smoke, like he'd lived in a heavily used locker room for 2 weeks without showering. It was probably the worst he'd ever smelled, and he couldn't fathom how Anna had managed to sleep in the same room, the same bed, as him. There was no way he was going to Cade smelling like this. She'd never let him hear the end of it. After a long, hot shower, Ethan felt almost human again. His hangover was mostly gone, though his stomach still felt queasy at the idea of food. Regardless, he dressed and went to the kitchen, making a quick stop at the fridge to take out 2 6-packs of beer, and he smiled at the plate of pancakes sitting by the milk. He debated eating them, but instead shook his head and went out the back door to cross the yard to Cade's. Anna sat with Cade Alton at a glass-topped patio table in Cade's backyard, drinking tall glasses of iced tea as Cade kept an eye on the smoking grill nearby. The scent of cooking meat wafted from the grill, and Ethan had an odd, shuddery feeling in his gut, like his stomach was trying to turn itself inside out. He gave the 2 women a half-hearted wave and collapsed into one of the patio chairs. Setting the packs of beer on the ground beside him, he leaned forward to rest his forehead against the cool table with a whine that made him sound absolutely pathetic. He was past the point of caring.
Look who finally graced us with his presence,
Cade cooed in her lightly accented voice, ruffling his hair. Ethan didn't bother looking up as he lifted a hand just enough to stick his middle finger into the air. This merely sent Cade into a peal of laughter. Ethan couldn't think of a single time when she'd actually taken offense to an insult he'd lobbed at her in the entire 7 years they'd been friends. Ethan dropped his hand back to the table with a thump.
Why exactly are we grilling out in January?
He asked Cade.
Because it's an unseasonably warm 69 degrees, and I'm a shameless carnivore,
Cade responded. She took a deep swallow from her tea and set the glass down beside Ethan. He jerked up a few inches as the thud rang through his head.
Hun, Anna's voice said from Ethan's left, did you find the aspirin I left you?
Yeah, I took it, he mumbled. And a shower. I still feel like shit, though.
You look like it, too,
Cade added gleefully. Ethan rolled his eyes and turned his head a fraction to look at her.
Don't you have someone else to insult?
Yes, but Drew's asleep right now,
she said, lifting her tea glass and taking another sip.
He just got back from a conference or something near Atlanta. I honestly wasn't paying much attention to what he was talking about. Some techie stuff that went over my head.
That wasn't an exaggeration. From what Ethan knew, Cade wasn't technologically inclined and could barely operate her smartphone on any given day. She slid out of her chair and went to the grill to turn the meat.
He's been sick, though, practically hacking his lungs out. I think he's got the flu or something, but he says it's just con crud and won't go to the doctor about it.
He'll do it if he isn't feeling well by Monday,
Anna assured Cade. Cade shook her head and made a face, directing her next statement to Ethan.
So you missed all the fun parts of our discussion out here.
What parts?
Ethan asked.
The parts where we discussed your... indiscretions from last night.
Ethan picked up a lemon slice from the small plate in the center of the table and threw it at the back of Cade's head. It bounced off her dark hair as his aim rang true.
I had no indiscretions, he replied.
Tell that to the poor bushes you desecrated,
Cade teased, waggling her smartphone at him before stuffing it back in her pocket. One of his co-workers must have sent her the photos from last night.
Son of a bitch must pay, his mind grumbled.
She set her tongs down and closed the grill's lid, turning back to him and smiling suddenly.
By the way, there's a certain four-year-old someone in the house who's been here for over a week and would probably love to see you before her mom gets here to pick her up at the first of the week.
Ethan sat up and rubbed his face as Cade's words sank in.
Josie's here?
He asked with more energy in his voice. Ever since he and Anna had found out they couldn't have children, Ethan had become ridiculously attached to his best friend's niece, and the little girl seemed equally enthusiastic to see her Uncle Ethan when she came all the way from Israel to visit Cade. Anna smiled and motioned to the sliding glass doors, leading into the kitchen.
She was in the living room last time I saw her, she said, watching TV.
SpongeBob, Cade added, returning to her chair. She's obsessed. It drives me nuts. I get that theme song stuck in my head for hours. Nothing will drive you crazier faster than the same damn pirate on TV 18 dozen times a day.
Ethan laughed and stood, making his way toward the house and leaving the two women in the backyard. After stopping at the fridge to drop off the beer, he headed into the living room. A little girl in a pink sweatshirt and khaki pants, her brown hair plaited, sat on the floor in front of the television, watching transfixed as the yellow sponge and his pink friend did heaven only knew what inside a cardboard box. Ethan grinned as he watched her, reluctant to interrupt her fascination with the show. He waited for a commercial break before sneaking up and grabbing her from behind.
What do you think you're doing?
He asked in a mock menacing voice. Josie squealed and laughed, twisting around to see who it was.
Uncle Ethan! She squealed, throwing her small arms around his neck in a tight hug.
Hey, baby girl,
Ethan said, returning the hug before settling her against his hip.
How are you doing today?
Good, she said. Aunt Cade is making me a hot dog.
A hot dog, huh?
He said.
Your favorite food, right?
He couldn't stand hot dogs. There was just something about that particular bit of meat that made him cringe inside. He was sure the repeated readings of Upton Sinclair's The Jungle in high school hadn't helped any. After that, he was surprised he hadn't become vegetarian.
Yes, Josie answered with an enthusiastic nod. Is it done yet? I'm hungry.
I don't know, honey. Let's go outside and find out, Ethan suggested.
He carried her to the back patio doors. As he passed the doorway leading to the den, he caught sight of a lump under a blanket on the couch. He assumed it was Cade's boyfriend, Andrew, taking a nap after his weekend-long trip to Georgia. Ethan left him alone and headed out the back door. Anna and Cade remained at the table talking as Ethan joined them once more. He settled Josie on his lap and rubbed her back as he stole Anna's glass of tea for a sip.
I figured the other lady in the house should join our fun out here, he said as his wife swatted at him and took her drink back.
Cade grinned and got up from her chair to retrieve a covered plate from beside the grill.
Perfect timing, Josie. Your hot dog is ready,
she announced dramatically, carrying the plate over to set it in front of Ethan and Josie.
You'll help her if she needs it?
She asked Ethan as she passed behind him.
Is that even a legitimate question?
Ethan asked. He grinned and pulled Josie's pigtails back, pretending to tie them together into a bow as Cade sat back down.
I was thinking about having a movie night tonight,
Cade said thoughtfully. She swirled her straw through her tea.
Maybe pulling some of those movies I added to Netflix last week and haven't watched yet. The four of us could kick back after Josie goes to bed. What do you think?
Are we required to be there?
Ethan teased, looking at Anna. She smiled and, as their eyes met, winked.
Well, of course,
That's why I'm telling you about it,
Cade replied. Her tone hinted at just what she thought of Ethan's intelligence level, and it wasn't much. Anna and Ethan looked at each other for a moment. Then Ethan said,
I don't know, Cade. We'll sit it out this time. I was thinking about spending some quality time with my wife this evening.
Anna reached over and grabbed his hand, and he returned the smile she gave him at his words. Cade's grin became mischievous as she raised her eyebrows.
Oh, I see what kind of evening you're going to have, she said knowingly.
But, Uncle Ethan, there's gonna be popcorn,
Josie said. Her voice was muffled, her mouth full of hot dog.
Aunt Cade always makes popcorn when she watches movies with me.
You shouldn't talk with your mouth full, Jose,
Ethan said, fluffing her bangs playfully.
Anna and I haven't gotten to hang out in about a week. We've both been working.
Cade smiled and said,
You two need to make me an aunt already. I don't care how you do it. You can freaking adopt for all I care.
But you're already an aunt, Aunt Cade,
Josie said, as if this should have been obvious. Ethan laughed softly and shrugged at Cade as he pressed his nose against the back of Josie's hair.
We'll see, he said. I'm not exactly in a hurry, and neither is Anna.
He'd yet to tell Cade about the last doctor's appointment 6 months before, when he and Anna had found out for certain that they couldn't have children. The last thing he wanted right now was to discuss it with someone other than Anna, even if it meant excluding his best friend from the news. Anna gave Ethan's hand another affectionate squeeze.
He'll be the first to know if something happens, she said. Right, Eth?
He nodded.
Oh, definitely. If I ever decided to tell someone something before you, Cade, he'd probably kill me.
And he had no doubt she'd be successful at it, too. Cade's face brightened.
Speaking of killing, you need to check out my new toy.
An ominous feeling settled into Ethan's gut at her words, replacing the queasy, hungover feeling he'd had all morning.
Your new toy,
he repeated. Anna held out her arms for Josie and grinned.
Oh, you'll like it, she assured him,
shifting the girl to her lap and sliding her plate back in front of her.
She showed it to me earlier. It's something right up your alley.
Doesn't make me any less scared at the idea of Cade and her toys, he replied.
Cade's toys were infamous among their friend group. They usually tended toward the extremely sharp, mildly explosive, and always dangerous ends of the spectrum. Given that she had so many assorted guns and knives hidden around the house, Ethan was amazed that Cade's older sister Lindsay let her keep Josephine for extended periods of time. Cade led them into the house through the kitchen and living room, and up the stairs to the master bedroom. Ethan shoved his hands into his pockets and rocked on his heels as he looked around. A photo of Cade in her IDF uniform sat on the table by the bed, multicolored ribbon mounted at the bottom of the photograph. He couldn't remember what the award was for. Cade threw open her closet door and hauled out a large black case, slinging it onto the bed. Then she went to the dresser, yanked a drawer open, and dug through its contents. Ethan smoothed his hand over the case's rough plastic surface and studied it curiously. It was a rifle storage case, and he had a feeling that whatever was inside was going to prove just as deadly as every other interesting item Cade owned. Cade produced a small silver key from the drawer and slid it into the lock holding the case closed.
This is seriously the best thing I've ever bought, she informed him as she twisted the key.
She slowly opened the case to reveal a deadly-looking rifle nestled in its padded innards. Ethan let out a low whistle. He recognized the weapon vaguely. He'd seen its type before in a movie or on a television show, but couldn't exactly place what it was.
What kind of rifle is this?
It's an IMI Galil Sar,
Cade replied. Ethan whistled again. That was a name he'd heard before.
Impressive. I'm assuming this is legal,
he teased, giving Cade a light jab in the side. She danced aside and lifted the rifle out of its case, holding it in both hands. her grip as sure as if she'd been using it for years. She probably had. Cade smirked and tore her gaze away from the rifle.
I don't know, Eth. It's a great idea to show my best friend, who just so happens to be a cop, the rifle I illegally own, don't you think?
She put the rifle away as gently as a mother would tuck in her child, locked the case once more, and gave the lid a tug to make sure it was secure.
So, how about those burgers and beer?
She offered, motioning for Ethan to follow her out of the room after a quick stop at the dresser to return the key to its hiding place. As they passed through the kitchen, Ethan noticed a newspaper lying on the table, and he scooped it up as a small sidebar headline caught his attention.
Mysterious illness sweeps Atlanta, he read out loud. What's up with this?
With what?
She asked, leaning to glance at the headline and shrugging.
I don't know. Just some flu or something going around. You know, the usual bullshit.
Damn. Are you sure?
Ethan asked, scanning the article. The details were vague. His eyes caught the byline and he frowned at the unusual name. Avi Geller. With as light as the article was on details, he figured it wasn't anything major and set the paper back on the table. If it had been something important, he'd imagined that the article would have a hell of a lot more detail than that. Shaking it loose from his attention, he began gathering plates and utensils.
Come on, let's go eat,
he said.
I'm starving.
New Orleans, Louisiana.
I think there's something going on in Atlanta,
Remy said over dinner. Her words broke through the otherwise quiet sounds of the meal, the tapping of forks against plates and the soft thumps of glasses being set on the table. Her family had never been very talkative at the dinner table. Maddie's chatter about school usually filled the space of time while the table was being set, and once the eating began, everyone was largely silent. So when Remy spoke up, it was unusual enough an event that it shook everyone from their focus on the food before them, and they turned their eyes on her. She suddenly felt like she'd made a faux pas, and she barely refrained from shifting uncomfortably in her chair under their intense, scrutinizing gazes.
What kind of something?
Remy's stepfather Jason asked. He lowered his fork to rest the tines against the edge of his plate and raised an eyebrow.
Rioting or something. I saw some tweets about it online, though there wasn't anything about it on the news. What I did see didn't sound too good. Somebody mentioned something about the military. I didn't see anything like that last night,
Remy's mother said. She was a flight attendant for United Airlines, and she frequently went on the short-haul flights from New Orleans to Atlanta and back.
Everything seemed fine. The plane wasn't delayed or anything.
It didn't start until after you left there, Mama, Remy said, fighting to keep the annoyance out of her voice.
Not to mention you didn't leave Hartsfield-Jackson the entire time you were there.
Remy, don't talk to your mother that way,
Jason admonished.
Give her the respect you're supposed to. You're not my father,
Remy muttered under her breath, but she knew the words were loud enough for all of them to hear.
Don't tell me what to do.
Remy, please, her mother said in a long-suffering tone. This was an argument they'd had before, and Remy was as tired of it as her mother was.
Not at the dinner table. Save it for when we're washing up afterwards, okay?
Remy grimaced, but she clamped her mouth shut. It wasn't worth it to argue with her mother, especially not after the whole tattoo debate earlier that evening. Maddie, however, didn't share Remy's sense of when to shut her mouth.
I heard at school that there are sick people in Atlanta that are causing people to fight, she announced,
prodding at her potatoes with a look of boredom.
Michelle's dad lives near Atlanta, and he told our mom that it's bad over there. He said,
Now look, you got your sister started,
Jason said accusingly to Remy. She fought the irrational urge to stab her fork into the back of his hand.
What happened to having a nice family dinner without all the talk of murders and whatever awful stuff you imagine?
Who said anything about murders?
She asked.
Shit, you act like I make stuff up all the damn time. Whatever happened to, I don't know, believe in me when I tell you shit?
Watch your language,
Remy's mother scolded. Especially at the dinner table. Lord, I could smack your father for letting you talk like that. It took everything in Remy to not say something she'd later regret. She set her fork down against the edge of her plate, put her napkin on the table beside both, and stood, intent on retreating to her room, content to allow her mother and stepfather to not only think they'd had the last word, but to let them gloat over it in private. Once she was in her room, the door locked firmly behind her, Remy went to her closet and started ransacking it for a change of clothes. As she climbed the stairs to the second floor, she'd been seized by the firm desire to get the hell out of the house. She didn't have a car, which made getting out nearly impossible, so after she dug a pair of jeans and a comfortable t-shirt out of her closet, she grabbed her cell phone, accessed the address book, and selected the listing that said, Adam. She put it on speakerphone while she changed clothes. "Lo?" Adam answered, his mouth sounding like it was full of food. "You busy tonight?" she asked. "As busy as I always am," he said, which basically meant he didn't have a damn thing going on. "Good," she said. "Then you can play chauffeur for me. I need to go into town." "What do you need to go into town for?" "Business." Adam groaned. "And I get to play chauffeur for that? Come on, man." "Fine. I'll cut you in to make up for the trouble. 20%. 30. 25. Adam sighed loudly. "Fine. 25. Good enough, I guess. When you get here, park at the end of the drive. I'll meet you there." "Where are we gonna hit this time?" Adam asked. "I'm not sure yet. It'll hit me before too long." She found the bag she was looking for, a larger, slouchier one that would hold a lot of stuff, and started gathering the little things to go inside it. "I'll see you in a few, yeah?"
Yeah,
Adam mumbled before he hung up. Remy tossed her cell phone into the bag with everything else, then shouldered the mostly empty bag, opened one of her bedroom windows, and slunk out onto the porch's roof to make her way to the ground and meet her friend. Plantersville, Mississippi. The crack of pool balls drowned out the country music being piped through the speakers strategically hidden around the bar. Gray paid the sound no mind, his eyes following the yellow ball Jack Abernathy had struck. It rolled into the pocket Jack had aimed for. Gray shook his head, taking a deep swallow from his beer, as Jack tilted his head to look at him and give him his familiar, shit-eating grin.
"Carter, you are going to owe me some serious money when I'm done with you," Jack taunted.
Gray tugged a pack of cigarettes from the back pocket of his jeans, pulling one free and lighting it.
"I said I liked playing. I never said I was good at it. Besides, you're probably going to give me the cash back anyway, like you do pretty much every time we play."
He propped the end of his pool cue on the floor and leaned on it, dragging his cigarette and watching Jack take entirely too long to line up his next shot.
"You going to take that shot anytime soon, or are you too busy waggling your ass for the ladies at the bar?"
Jack tapped the cue ball. The green ball that had been his target bounced off the table's side, rolling to a stop in the center of the table. Gray heaved a sigh of relief and ashed his cigarette into the tray on the edge of the table, then lifted his stick from the floor.
"About damned time."
Jack leaned against the edge of the table and Gray circled it, trying to choose his best line of attack.
"I don't think you've noticed, G," he said, "but I'm not the one the ladies at the bar are staring at. That hot brunette near the end has been watching you the entire time we've been in here."
Gray stretched over the table to line up his shot, resting the pool cue against his hand and cut his eyes in the direction Jack mentioned. He huffed out another impatient breath.
"Come on, man. There's like three of them down there," he said,
though a jolt of recognition wormed its way down his spine when his eyes met those of the girl in question. He stuck his cigarette between his lips and exhaled a puff of smoke around it, feigning casualness, before taking his shot and missing miserably. It was an easy shot, and Gray could only account his failure to make it as a bad case of sudden nerves brought on by the eyes that, even now, he could have sworn he felt on his back. The one in the skirt and red top, Jack replied. He passed behind Gray to get to the other side of the table, slapping him on the back in the process. Gray flinched and sidestepped away from him, gripping the pool cue tighter, barely containing the urge to smack Jack with it.
You should go talk to her, see if you can get laid, Jack suggested. Then maybe you'll quit being so damned cranky all the time.
Gray cocked his hip against the edge of the table, took his cigarette out of his mouth, and snagged his beer bottle from beside the ashtray.
Do I look that desperate?
He drank a deep swig of beer.
At least let me wait until the game's over before you start trying to hook me up with random bar chicks.
Jack snorted.
Dude, I've gotta hook you up. God knows you can't get the pretty girls on your own.
He joked.
If we weren't in the bar right now, I'd so kick your ass, Gray said.
He jabbed his cigarette out in the ashtray with more ferocity than necessary and finished off his beer.
But you can't, because then Smitty'll call the cops and your brother would want to know why you were in the brass monkey in the first place and why he was bailing you out of jail. He'd probably get all paternal on you and I'd never get to hang out with you again.
Jack sank another ball.
What's with him anyway? He acts like you're 12 or something.
Gray grabbed his empty bottle, setting the pool cue on the edge of the table.
I don't want to talk about my brother. It's his fault I'm here with you anyway since he canceled on me. And don't talk about him that way. It's between him and me.
He nodded to the bar.
I'm going to get another drink.
Circling the table, he tossed his empty bottle into the trash and headed to the bar. He stopped a few feet away from the girl Jack had pointed out. The girl who'd been staring at him. The girl who'd given him such a rush of feeling the second he'd laid eyes on her that he'd felt the compulsion to sit down in a daze. He flagged down the bartender, the esteemed Smitty himself.
Can I get another beer, please?
He glanced at the girl out of the corner of his eye and added,
Make it two.
Once he had the two chilled bottles in his hand, he slid onto the stool beside the girl, cracked the top off of one of the bottles, and set it on the counter in front of her.
Hey, April. Long time no see.
She looked up at him, a wide smile spreading across her pretty face. The sight of it sent a pang of melancholy through him.
I was hoping you'd take the hint and come over here, she said.
Gray hadn't seen April Linder in nearly 3 years, not since they'd graduated high school and gone their separate ways. They'd dated throughout their entire junior and senior years, and things had started getting serious between them until his parents had died in an accident 2 months before graduation. Thinking about that time of his life still made him sad. 2 years was a lot of time for a teenager to spend with one girl. He dragged himself out of memory lane and returned April's smile.
You're looking great. What have you been doing?
April tucked her hair behind her ear in a familiar gesture, then scooped up the beer he'd put in front of her and sipped from the bottle.
Not a whole lot. Just moved back home.
She scrunched up her nose, and he noticed the freckles speckling her cheeks and the bridge of her nose.
College sucks, by the way. Don't even bother with it.
I take it things didn't go well in Seattle?
Oh, God, no.
April grimaced.
I spent the whole time being miserable and getting ridiculed for my accent.
Assholes,
he said.
Tell me about it.
April took another sip of beer. Gray felt her eyes running over him during the pause between them, like she was physically running her hands over his skin.
You're not looking all that bad yourself. Not as skinny as the last time I saw you. More muscular, I think.
Gray gulped from his bottle.
I guess that's what happens when you haul car parts around all day. Well, that and the occasional visit to the gym.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.